Well, hi everyone and greetings from Northern Michigan. This is Bob the Science Guy. You know, as a YouTube creator, I'm constantly looking for ways to improve my channel and maybe tweak the format a little bit and just improve interest amongst viewers. And this is one such example. You know, I've spent the last year looking at the Flat Earth movement with benign curiosity and amusement. And a couple of observations I've made. First, the Flat Earth movement is basically the pet rock of YouTube. It is something that YouTube allows people with rather strange beliefs to find each other and come together as a group and feel a sense of community. And in that sense of community, they have to look to somebody as a leader. So there are several kind of centers of mass in the Flat Earth movement. Eric Dubay, Nathan Oakley, Bob Nodell from Globusters. These are people that many in this community look up to for their answers in science, failing, however, to realize that what these people are doing is basically running a Jerry Springer-style talk show and selling t-shirts. It's very difficult to attack them directly because, like Samuel Robotham in the 19th century, they have relatively little education, but they are very good at making arguments and spouting logical fallacies and coming up with bizarre theories to explain away things that have been well established in science for centuries, such as the sporosity of the Earth and gravity. Every now and then you will find somebody that hovers around these centers of masses, like little planets in orbit around the sun. And they put out things using these theories that these thought leaders have come up with that are open to attack. Now, one such individual is this guy, Mr. This is an Egg Sleeping Warrior. Now, while Sleeping Warrior seems to have much more importance in YouTube than he does anywhere else, he's kind of a fun target to look at once in a while. Now, one of his efforts was this particular experiment right here. This is a seventh grade science experiment where you take an egg, you put it in a glass of fresh water, the egg sinks. You put a little salt into it to increase the density of the water medium, and due to the rules of buoyancy, the egg then floats. There are things like measurements and units of measurements and using the proper tools and writing things down that would normally go along with seventh grade science that seem to have been skipped with a lot of this. But it was quite amusing, and I actually did a video on this a few months ago. But that's not what we're here for today. We're here for this one.
So we could have approached this problem in a couple of different ways. We could have tried to do it theoretically, but that's no fun. So let's go out and get a couple of bowling balls and throw them in a tank of water and see if they're gonna float. Take the first one, you dump it in, and it doesn't float. And then there's another what looks to be identical bowling ball, and you dump it in the water, and it's just barely floating. Put the third bowling ball in there, and guess what? It floats even better than the second one. So now people want to know why. And you could go get to one of your physics professors and say, what makes things float? And the answer is density, density, density. And the answer is density. And you know, your physics professor will tell you it's the weight compared to the volume. And then the question is, can you figure this out?
So in the next couple of episodes, what we're going to do is we're going to have a chat with Dr. Pinizzotto and have him respond to this video and discuss a few other things related to science. So the purpose of this is twofold. Number one is we are going to put to rest a number of silly flat earth theories about how things work. Everything from why do corks float to why do rocks fall. And second, just for fun, we are going to crush the souls of Sleeping Warrior and the rest of the Flat Earth community. So cue up the music and let's go. So now I'm joined by Dr. Russell Pinizzotto, who is contacting us from the wilds of rural Maine in the middle of a blizzard with internet carried on by carrier pigeon. So he wants to go ahead and respond to this video that he put out when he was associated with the Wentworth Institute of Technology, was it?
Yes, Doctor? That's correct.
Okay. So Let's go ahead and turn it over to him. And if you would be so kind, tell us a little bit about yourself, Dr. Pinizzotto, some of your background, some of your interests in your profession, et cetera.
Well, I've been in higher education for about 30 years. I've been at six different schools. I retired a few years ago, but I still do interim placements. I was provost, which is the senior vice president for academic affairs at Wolfie. My background is I have a PhD in engineering, a master's degree in astronomy, and a bachelor's degree in chemistry.
Excellent. And what kind of engineering do you do?
I did material science, mainly in semiconductor materials, but also in metals and ceramics. In particular, I looked at what's called the microstructure of materials using electron microscopy.
Okay, so you're an engineer that we would go to determine whether or not we could use a new composite material in an aircraft wing or, a question about what kind of material would be best suited for the job. Would that be right?
Yeah, that's pretty much the case. And also how to process those materials and optimize their properties.
That's kind of a cool thing. You know, my family has a lot of engineering in it as well. My father's a mechanical engineer. My grandfather was a hydrologist and a civil engineer. And my brother is a nuclear engineer. So I've got a lot of engineering genes, and I actually have their slide rules. So the reason that I wanted to have a chat. You don't use slide rules anymore?
No, don't use them, but I still have them. Yeah, that's true.
They're great. We went to the moon on slide rules and in statute miles. So let's go ahead and kind of hit what we're here for today. A few months ago, we had a video appear in the Flat Earth community here on YouTube that features you giving a talk about floating some bowling balls in a fish tank. And the big thing about it was they were using it as a proof that density rather than gravity is the important thing when it comes to objects falling to the earth, for example. Could you tell us a little bit about that experiment, what you were trying to demonstrate and to whom and in what setting?
Sure. So this was a demonstration for an open house, which is an event where prospective students come and check out the school, see if they would like the fall after they graduate. So what normally happens at things like these open houses is they get lectured to about it. But I wanted to do a demonstration instead of just a lecture. One of the principles that Wentworth really believes in is having students do things hands-on rather than just in a theoretical fashion. So my idea was to do things hands-on rather than just theoretical. And I've done a number of different demonstrations at open houses. And this particular one used three bowling balls that looked identical and to see if they would float in a big aquarium full of water. And as it turned out, one of them just sank to the bottom, one split from it, and the other one definitely did float. And I used the terminology that they have different density, which is true for the bowling balls because they all have the same overall volume, but they didn't weigh the same. The one that sank weighed about 16 pounds. The one that barely floated was 11 pounds, and the one that floated really well was 8 pounds. So it was to do a very quick demonstration. The way I set this up was I had one of the prospective students come up and say, "Can you make this bowling ball float?" And handed him the 16-pound bowling ball, in some cases. And when that person would put it in the tank of water, it just sank to the bottom. And then I said, "Well, look, here's a student from Wentworth. Let's see if they can make the bowling ball." And I'd call up one of our students and hand them the 12-pound bowling ball. And they put it in and it would barely float. And then finally, I said, "Well, here's what happens if you can get your PhD." And I would pick up the lightest one and put it in and it would just float fantastically well. Well, it was kind of a joke. It was kind of a demonstration that they would remember. And that was the whole point, that when they left this auditorium full of 1,000 people, that they would be talking about it, and they might even talk about it when they went home. So the idea of using the word density was just a shorthand. I didn't want to get into all the details about buoyancy and weight and the acceleration due to gravity and, you know, the relative densities and all those kinds of things. But unfortunately, the Flat Earth people picked that video up and, without talking to me about it, took pieces of it that I believe are out of context and decided to use it for their own purposes.
That's something that I wanted to ask you about. So again, this was not an instructional period in a classroom. This was a presentation that said, basically, look at the cool stuff you'll learn here at this institute, and this is our approach to things. We have something similar in medicine. We call it see one, do one, teach one. And then if you grow up to become a surgeon, you know, the bowling ball doesn't float. You can actually levitate it with the power of your personality. But that's why I became an internist. I'm not quite able to do that yet, but, you know, I'm working on the forehead to do it. So basically, here's the take home that I got from this, is you were demonstrating Archimedes' principle, which says primarily that the buoyant force has to do with the amount of water that the object displaces, reducing its weight by the same amount. So if the object weighs less than the water it displaces, it'll float. If it weighs more, it'll sink. And if it weighs the same as the water it displaces, it'll just remain neutrally buoyant. Is that pretty right?
That's correct, yes.
All right, now, it's not limited to just changing the density of the bowling ball, is it? You could take, say, that 11-pound bowling ball or an egg and put it in water and it would be neutrally buoyant or even sink. But if you added, say, some salt to it and increased the density of the fluid, the amount of fluid that it displaces actually goes up relative to the fixed weight of the egg or the bowling ball, and you can make it float just by dumping some salt in there and changing the density of the fluid it's in, right?
Yes, that would be a much more difficult demonstration for 1,000 people, though. So, but you could change the density of the fluid.
And by the way, you would check the density of the fluid with a device called a hydrometer, not a parts per million meter, right?
Parts per million meter, I guess we could relate it back in some complex fashion. That's certainly not the best way to do it. A hydrometer, like you use, say, to, in the old days, measure how much acid was in the batteries of your car, would be the best way to do it. That's true.
Okay. Well,
in fact, I've done some measurements for the water quality people here, and we do want to measure the salinity of the ocean water. And we use parts per million meters. We use hydrometers to do that.
Okay. Well, that's fair enough. Now, I think one of the big problems that we have is this confusion between density and buoyancy. The difference, of course, is that density would be an intrinsic property of a piece of material, and buoyancy is the interaction of the density of an object with an accelerating force, and in most cases here on Earth, that would be gravity, 9.81 meters per second squared downward, correct?
Yes, so when we're talking about floating something, we really have to look at the forces that are involved. And there are two forces. One force results in weight, and that's the force due to gravity. So when gravity acts on a mass, it gives it weight. So as you said, on Earth, the acceleration is 9.8 meters per second times whatever the mass is, and that gives us the weight of an object. You move that object so there was a different accelerating force, a different gravity, it would weigh a different amount. But on Earth's surface, that's the weight that we're usually clear of. When we put something into water, say, to see if it floats, there is what's called a buoyancy, which is a force that is upholding it. And that force is related to the amount of water displaced, as you said, the weight of that object is the other force. So those forces have to be in balance. So in the bowling ball case, they had the same volume, but they didn't have the same weight. So when you put the 16-pound bowling ball in water, it displaced that much water for the volume, but that was not, it did not generate a sufficient buoyant force to allow it to float. On the other extreme, the 8-pound bowling ball, when it displaces that amount of water, it wasn't underwater yet when it displaced the amount of water equal to its weight, and so on.
Okay, well, let's explore this just a little bit more. Would your bowling ball experiment have worked in an area with no gravitational acceleration, such as space, or a hyperbolic flight, the so-called vomit comet?
No. Like I said, there are two forces there that were being demonstrated. One is the downward force, the sinking force, if you want to think about it that way, due to gravity. The other one's the buoyant force. So without gravity, there is not the two forces to be put into equilibrium. And so that experiment would not work either in the vomit comet or in the space station.
Well, guys, I've got another 20 minutes worth of interview with Dr. Pinizzotto, so I'm going to go ahead and hold off here for now. Tomorrow, we're going to talk about whether or not this density tower will work in the absence of gravity. What do you think? We're also going to discuss the differences between Einsteinian and Newtonian gravity and whether or not one invalidates or supersedes the other, and how science approaches the difference between the two. So join me in this fascinating interview as we continue tomorrow. This is Bob the Science Guy signing out from Northern Michigan. Hey, make sure you hit that like and subscribe button down there and hit the bell icon so that you know when the next episode comes out. We're going to do this tomorrow and then we're going to finish up with Dr. Pinizzotto on Friday, and he has some choice words for Sleeping Warrior. Take care, guys.